Hello friends, in my previous lecture I told you about the type of inguinal hernia, indirect hernia, direct inguinal hernia and whether indirect is common or direct is common and which sex it is more common. So those are the things. Now in this lecture we will learn about the treatment of inguinal hernia. You know, inguinal hernia, once it occurs, particularly indirect inguinal hernia, it requires treatment because it can undergo a complication sometime in life. A direct inguinal hernia, complications are much less because the neck of the hernia is quite wide and broad. So the chances of complication as a result of obstruction or strangulation is much less. However, a indirect hernia has got a narrow neck, and if the contents coming through it are big, as it becomes over a period of time bigger and bigger, and if the contents get adherent inside the hernial sac outside the deep ring or superficial ring, in that case it may get obstructed or may get strangulated and can lead to life-threatening complications. So that's why most of the time inguinal hernia requires treatment. A direct hernia can wait, but also should be treated well in time, because it, in addition to its other complication, it does produce some kind of a dragging pain to the patient, and of course is cosmetically also it's not a good thing to have a big swelling in your inguinal region. Inguinal hernia is there are two objectives. One is management of the hernial sac per se, which has come out, and in addition you have to strengthen the inguinal canal and the posterior wall of the inguinal canal, because if you do not do that, there will be a recurrence in adult. This is in adults. In children, of course, it is only the patent process is vaginalis, so you only close that and that is good enough. You do not require a additional operation for strengthening the inguinal floor or the floor, the posterior wall of the inguinal canal. However, in adult you must do that, particularly for both indirect as well as direct inguinal hernia. So for dealing with the sac of the hernia, you have to open the various layers of the inguinal canal, dissect out the sac from the spermatic cord. For that you have to give us incise the cremastic fascia over the spermatic cord, dissect out the layers of the cremastic muscle, and then catch hold of the sac and slowly dissect the sac from all the other structures of the spermatic cord. Yesterday we learnt that there are about 9 or 10 structures inside the spermatic cord. So you have to slowly dissect out all the other structures, including the vas, the pemphigoid plexus, the artery to the vas, the testicular artery, the fat, the lymphatics, all those things, and just dissect out the hernial sac away from all the structures, and then reduce any content which is present inside the hernial sac. And for that you have to be careful. The sac, the contents may sometime be adherent inside the sac, so you may have to open up the sac sometime to release the contents. So once you have released all the contents and reduced them inside the peritoneal cavity, then you ligate the neck of the sac, and you may either excise it, or you may not actually ligate. If you have not opened the sac, you can just dissect it and push it inside the peritoneal cavity. So that is dealing with the sac. Sac of a direct hernia is generally has got a big wide neck, and that need not be ligated like in an indirect sac. So there you can just dissect it and push it back into the peritoneal cavity. So you have dealt with the hernial sac. Now comes dealing with the weak posterior wall of the hernial inguinal canal. How can you deal or make it stronger? For decades, for hundreds or more than 100 years, the standard surgery for strengthening the posterior wall used to be by some primary tissue repair. Some ligament from here or some muscle from there, or in attaching that to the inguinal canal, inguinal ligament. Those were the surgeries for almost 100 years. After that, for the last, say, 4 decades, synthetic meshes are available. Implants are available, which are generally called synthetic meshes. And these mesh are placed in that area to strengthen the posterior wall. So that has become now the standard of care. Nowadays, nobody does only a primary tissue repair. So some synthetic material, generally a synthetic mesh is put there. All this surgery till about 30 years back used to be done only by open surgery. However, over the last 30 years, particularly in the last 20 years, the surgery has become more and more commoner with laparoscopic surgery. So we will learn about all these 3 or 4 methods of surgery in inguinal hernia. One is the primary tissue repair. Second is the open surgery with mesh. And third is laparoscopic surgery with mesh, of course. Because these days nobody should be doing a hernia surgery without a mesh, because it has been definitely proved to be better than surgery without the mesh. And in the laparoscopic surgery, there are 2 types. One is total extraperitoneal, which is called TEP, or there is a transabdominal preperitoneal, which is called TAPP. You must be hearing about these 2 terms, TEP or TAPP. So we'll learn about these 2 also. So the primary tissue repair. Primary tissue repair, where you are not using any prosthetic material, you are only managing with the tissues available in that region. The advantage is you are not using any foreign body there. You are just patient's own tissue. You are just manipulating that. The disadvantage is recurrence rate is very high. It used to be sometimes 40% also in some of the surgeries. So it is no good doing a surgery which has got 40% recurrence. So patient will have to come back for another surgery, and then again 40% chance of recurrence. So this used to be an endless game. And the common surgeries for this tissue repair were Bassinis repair or Schölde's repair or a Holstead repair. These were the 3 commonest types. Most commonly, we used to do either a Bassinis repair or we used to do a Schölde's repair. Sometimes we used to do a repair called Darn repair, because that time meshes were not available. So some people used to use a nylon thread and take multiple sutures in one side and then across it. So ultimately you kind of form a mesh with a nylon suture. We used to make that mesh with a nylon suture. So that is like as if you are doing a darning of it in a cloth. So that darn repair used to be another way of repairing. But all these repairs used to be having a high recurrence rate. So nowadays practically nobody does a tissue repair. What is done is either a open mesh repair or a laparoscopic mesh repair. So let us go for that. Open mesh repair can be commonly 2 or 3 types are done. The most common one done is called Lichtenstein repair. So in Lichtenstein repair, it came by the name of tension-free mesh repair, anterior mesh repair. Posterior is through laparoscopically or other operations like Stopar's operation. So this used to be known as tension-free anterior repair. Why tension-free? Because it was realized that tension is not a good method of doing the hernia surgery, because if you put tension in the tissues, it is bound to give way and there will be recurrence. So in Lichtenstein, you deal with the hernial sac, then you put a mesh there which is fixed without any tension in that. Another repair which came was known as a patch and plug technique. In patch and plug technique, you put a plug of the mesh in the deep ring to plug the hernia coming out from there, and then you also put a patch of the mesh on the posterior wall of the hernia inguinal canal so that the posterior wall is strengthened. So these were the common type of surgery done in the open surgery. Then came the laparoscopic era. And laparoscopy has now become very popular, though it is still not considered a gold standard, but it has become very popular, and most of the time the patients are now being offered by hernia surgery by laparoscopy. The two types done in that are TEP and TAPP. In both the cases, what you are doing is actually you are placing a mesh in the preperitoneal region. In TEP, you are doing it without going through the abdominal cavity, and in TAPP, you do the same repair but after going through the abdominal cavity. So you raise a flap of the peritoneum, dissect out the preperitoneal space and put the mesh there. The advantage of preperitoneal repair, whether TEP or TAPP, is that you can actually cover the whole of that area, which is called which is the hernia producing area, that is inguinal, the femoral, the obturator. All that weak areas are covered by one mesh placed there. Generally we place a mesh of approximately 15 by 12 centimeter, or you can put a bigger mesh if required, so that it covers all the three areas of the hernia: inguinal, obturator hernia or femoral hernia. So all those weak spots are covered by one mesh and is fixed in the place by either one or two stitches or one or two staplers, or what is called as tackers, or you can fix the mesh with a glue. So you can do this and fix the mesh there and then close the peritoneum over that in TAPP. In TEP, you do not require to close the peritoneum because you do not go transperitoneal. So these are the three methods of, two methods of doing laparoscopic surgery. The anesthesia. Now, a open surgery, because you must be knowing that most of these hernias, they occur in a slightly elderly age group, particularly the direct hernia. And patients will have a lot of comorbidities. So, it is better to avoid a general anesthesia and also, if possible, a spinal anesthesia or epidural anesthesia, and it can be easily done under local anesthesia. That is, if you are doing an open surgery. But if you are doing a laparoscopic surgery, then of course you require a general anesthesia, which is much better for a TAPP. TEP can sometimes be done under a spinal or epidural surgery, epidural anesthesia. I must tell you about a few important landmarks which should be known when you are trying an laparoscopic surgery, particularly TAPP. Because there are three landmarks which have been described in the anatomy there. If you are a little careless while doing the surgery and dissection in that area, you can land up with severe complications which can be life-threatening. So you should be knowing about these important landmarks. The important landmarks, these three landmarks, are called Triangle of Doom, Triangle of Pain and Corona Mortis, or the Circle of Death. Names of course sound very dangerous and very dangerous, that it can kill, the hernia surgery can kill a patient, but no, it is a very safe surgery, but you have to know about these dangerous spots, because if you do not know these dangerous spots, you can create problem for the patient, but if you are careful, you will not create any problem. Hernia surgery is very safe. You have to know about this. So, Triangle of Doom. Triangle of Doom. I'll show you a picture. It will become much clearer if you look at this picture. The Triangle of Doom, if you see, there are two pictures in this. One is the diagrammatic picture, other is the laparoscopic picture of that area. As you bring down the peritoneum from the posterior anterior abdominal wall, you put it down, you can see that testicular vessels are running on one side and vas deferens is running on the other side. Vas goes medially towards the urinary bladder, testicular vessels go towards the retroperitoneum laterally. So it makes a triangle like this. The area in between these two structures, the testicular vessels and the vas, vas on the medial side, testicular vessels on the lateral side. The area in between these two is the is called the triangle of Doom. Why Doom? Because two important vessels, the external iliac artery and external iliac vein, they are just running in the floor of this triangle. So if you are not careful, you can damage the external external iliac artery or external iliac vein. Both can bleed very massively. So that is what is called as triangle of Doom. Now let us learn about the other one, the triangle of pain. Again, I will show you the picture, similar picture, one diagrammatic picture, other is a laparoscopic surgery picture. If you see, I told you about the triangle of Doom. This is vas, this is testicular vessel. If you go lateral to the testicular vessels, towards the anterior superior iliac spine, this side, the area outside that, if you dissect it a little deeper, you will see the psoas muscle underneath that. If you are dissecting on the right, you will see the right psoas muscle, and it is covered with a fascia. If you look carefully, without removing that fascia, you can see some nerves running on there. So the common nerves running there are the lateral cutaneous nerve of thigh and femoral branch of the genitofemoral nerve. These are the two nerves which can be seen through that fascia. You need not remove the fascia. The idea is to know that this triangle is triangle of pain, because if you put a stapler there while fixing the mesh, or if you do too much of dissection or cautery or something and you damage these nerves, patient will have a constant pain in the post-operative period because these nerves get irritated. So you have to learn about this triangle of Doom and triangle of pain. Now comes the corona mortis or the circle of death. Circle of death is an area which is like, again I am showing you the picture. One is the diagrammatic picture, other is the laparoscopic picture. You can see that there are some important vessels there. Common iliac, external iliac, then there is the obturator artery and there is inferior epigastric artery. So there is kind of circle of vessels around this, around the neck of the sac. Hernial sac is going there, and around the neck of the sac there are external iliac, common iliac, inferior epigastric artery and obturator artery. So these four arteries around that, they join together, and this is a big, all are big vessels. So if you damage any of these vessels, there can be severe bleeding. So this circle of the vessel is called corona mortis. Now, like blood vessels, there are some important nerves also in relation to the hernia surgery, and they should be identified and protected, because damage to these nerves can cause constant pain in that area. These nerves, they supply the area around that. Most important one is the ilioinguinal nerve, which can be damaged in open surgery. In laparoscopic surgery, it doesn't come into the view. But in open surgery, it is the first nerve you come across as you open the facial layers. And this nerve, it supplies the proximedial part of the skin of the thigh, medial side of the thigh, the skin over the penile root, as well as upper part of the scrotum. So if you damage this nerve, patient will have either paresthesia or anesthesia of that part of the skin. The other nerves are iliohypogastric nerves and genitofemoral nerve. The iliohypogastric nerve divides into two branches, lateral and anterior, and they supply the posterolateral part of the gluteal skin, or anterior cutaneous branch supplies the suprapubic skin. Similarly, the genitofemoral nerve supplies the genital, it has got two branches, genital and femoral. The genital one supplies the cremastic muscle and the scrotal skin, and the femoral one supplies the passes behind the inguinal ligament and supplies the part of the anterior upper part of the femoral triangle area, that skin anterior to that. So these areas, if these nerves are damaged or disturbed or partially damaged, then patient may have a paresthesia or anesthesia in that part, and that is quite troubling. So we have discussed the various types of treatment of inguinal hernia. I have told you the open surgery. In open surgery, initial era, which is probably now gone, is primary repair with the tissues around, tissue repair. Then came the era of open mesh repair. And now, for last about 25-30 years, is the era of increasing era of laparoscopy. Open surgery is still being done, whereas more and more laparoscopic surgery, which is either TEP or TAPP. And in the TEP or TAPP, what are the dangers? Dangers to the major blood vessels or major nerves. We have discussed all that. I hope you will remember this. This will not only help you in understanding of the inguinal hernia and its repair, as well as help you in solving MCQ questions. Thank you very much.